has get to hear a little bit about some of the climate change that they explored on this trip. So I hope you enjoy it. We have really, really have the benefit of having Mr. Hardy here to be able to answer any and all questions that you have about the film and anything else. And without anything else, let me hand the mic over to Mr. Hardy.
Thank you, John. Just a few words of introduction, and we'll have a half hour or an hour after to answer any questions you may have. I'm a Greenwich resident, a French American, but I've been here about 30 years, and I'm an investor in technology, both in France and in the US. I spend half my life doing that, and the other half I do this kind of work and expeditions and exploration and adventure. And I'm also vice president of Green Cross International, which is an NGO founded by Mikhail Gorbachev from Russia, and presided by Jean-Michel Cousteau, whom you all know, the son of the famous Captain Cousteau. So I do environmental work there as well, and you'll see more of that in the film. I led this expedition, I did put it together, now it's about 3 years ago, and the expedition itself was 2 years ago, was a result of an idea I had of going in these locations in the footsteps of Shackleton, Anglo-Irish explorer from the beginning of the 20th century, so about 100 years ago, who got stuck in the ice, and you'll see the story as he was trying to cross the continent of Antarctica. So let you watch the film now, back in 52 minutes to answer all your questions. All right, enjoy.
Each lived through a unique experience, and inspired by the spirit of Shackleton, tested their nerves. And while climate issues are more relevant than ever, this expedition will perhaps contribute to preserving the balance of these polar areas, essential for the future of our planet.
All right. You happy to take any questions? After thanking Bertrand Delacquer, who is the most important guy who we do not see in the film because he's filming going up the mountain, early in the morning. So I called even before Geraldine with his equipment to film what we see in that film. So he's a great guy. Yes, sir.
Did Violet get in the way?
Did the wildlife get in the way? No, the weather certainly did a lot get in the way. Wildlife, they're kind of like Galapagos, where they are not afraid of humans because they don't see any or many, and they've been used to be just to deal with themselves. So it was more us not approaching them too close, as opposed to us being bothered. Even the whales at sea, and you see them from far away, and we didn't get any tragic encounter with wildlife. Yes. Technically we could, because they come so close, especially the youngsters and these penguins, a few ones which are either young, but less than a year old, especially if you, kind of sit and don't walk around them. If you walk around them like this, but they're about that high, yeah, they will run away. Otherwise, they will literally come at you, but you don't want to touch them, you want to infect them with whatever you want to be carrying. Yes? In general, these are extreme environments, although in this particular expedition, it was not the toughest I've done personally. into the North Pole. It's much more difficult. You pull a sled, you know, 8-10 hours a day. It's very humid. You can go through the ice. It's difficult. And parting the continent, I was there years ago, climbing the highest peak there, it's -50, -70 degrees, super cold. So that's tough. Here, the toughest part was being on a boat and being always, you know, moved around because the weather is bad 95% of the time. I really suffered, and actually all of us, including the skipper, Ben, of the boat, really suffered at times from these very rough seas. All the way in the back, yes. It's very loud. I need some relay. Sorry, can someone repeat the question for me, maybe? For an extra microphone.
Did you ever recover? Did you recover the buoys and things that were thrown?
What happens to the floats, basically, once when they are thrown in the water? They are not meant. There are about 4,000 of them in the world oceans, and they are, you know, thrown in the water. And then we can follow them literally the next day. You see toward the end, you know, the screen where you see the floats. It's open source data. You can follow what they're doing, but they are meant to die, you know, a couple of years after they're thrown and the battery is dead. They're meant to die in the water, so they would fall on the seafloor. Presumably, they're very well sealed, so that they would not pollute the oceans. Just one more piece of mail at the bottom of the ocean. Yes? The favorite for me was, you know, being really like a kid with all this wildlife, and especially the penguins. I'd never seen penguins in their environment before, so that, I must say that's exciting, especially when you have like 300,000 of them around you. And the worst part for me was really being on a boat, you know, when you cross from point A to point B, and you know, 5 days at sea and nothing happens, you said that you're always moved around. That's been my goal. Yes? Good question. It takes about 2 years, you know, between the idea and really thinking about who I'm going to go with and where and when. But the year prior to leaving, so we were there October 14, you know, fall of 14, I really started to spend more time preparing. And for example, just finding the boat, the skipper, took me months. I interviewed 9 skippers, you know, understanding their boat, and I wanted to make sure that I had the best possible. That alone took a few months to do, and then assembling the team. So I would say it's about a year working part time on it. It takes a while. Yes. Sure. I've always plans for the future expeditions. Next year, I'm trying to, I say trying because there are so many parameters which have to, you know, converge so that these expeditions happen. But I'm planning to go in the Russian Arctic, northeastern Siberia, in the rarely visited islands there, which have a historical value. Also, the issue of permafrost there is important, you know, permafrost, which is melting. In Russia, 2/3 of Russia is permafrost. Methane is being emitted when permafrost melts, and that's 23 times more potent than CO2. So that's a big problem coming up. And also there's the mammoth issue. We can now find mammoth tusks, and sometimes body parts of mammoth in these parts of the world. So that's very interesting in terms of paleontology and all that. Yes? Emotionally it was fine because we were Well, we were isolated, but we were a group of 12. It's not always 12 at the same time. So actually, sometimes you wanted to get away from these guys because you are 6 weeks with them, and you don't get along with everyone, but some people you prefer, some not. So when I was in Antarctica in 2003 for this Mount Vincent climb, we were just three of us for one full month, and that's much more difficult because you're really, really isolated. At the time, there was less ways to communicate. And back then, in the middle of the continent, if you have an accident, you break a leg, well, you stop. You just have to take your morphine, and it's less painful, but that's it. When you have a boat like this, you know, there are other people, you can move somewhere else, you can maybe have a cruise ship crossing your way and be rescued, so that's better for the mental. Yes, and then. Oh, no comparisons, because our trip was only 6 weeks, and Shackleton, his entire ordeal was almost 2 years. So, I mean, what we did is not a reenactment, it's not trying to do the same thing, it's just inspired by, and we, you know, in the footsteps of, but in terms of time, there's no comparison. And they didn't know if they would be alive the next day, actually, when we knew that we would be except for major accident. Yes. That we would. Yes. Well, there were doubts that we would not be able to do the crossing at all, and that was the main goal of the expedition, was to cross South Georgia Island. With, you know, all the rares, the science and all this, but kind of deep inside, all of us wanted to cross this island because that's the most famous part of Shackleton's expedition. So it would have been a major, major drawback not being able to do that. And yes, it was basically with the weather, and we had to do that little thing, which would, you know, if you were in the Catskills, you'd do that in 10 hours. And, you know, it took Shackleton 36 hours and one shot, and it took us three different segments, three different days to do it. So, yeah, there were absolutely doubts. There were no doubts that we could complete the expedition, there were doubts what we would do and not do. Ladies. Yeah, and then you. Yeah. Well, blue first, and then you. Is that right? Sorry, I didn't get that. Oh, the data. The flows of the data was available right away. Open source, you know, connect on the website, and you get these flows along with the 4,000 flows, where they are, the temperature, pressure, and other data depending on the type of flows. There will be a paper, hopefully in 2017, done by this science group in France about this particular region, you know, the currents and the countercurrents and the eddies and what's going on there in the ocean. Same for the snow samples. They should be, and I'm keeping in touch with these guys. Apart from that, there is no way we have been able to cross the entire continent alive. It's probably, we would all have died on the way or after reaching the South Pole. So that was a lucky break. So that's something I kind of understood by going through all that process. The best book to read is actually the book by Shackleton himself, which is named South. And it's just great adventure, and with this beautiful English from, you know, early image, English from the early 20th century, is just amazing. And there is another book which has most of the photos, black and white photos, which is by Carol Alexander, with a brown cover, which is a great book as well. I'm happy to, you know,
give a couple of references to John Dillinger after. And in terms of film, there is also the original black and white film. When you see the black and white film we have, we have the photos and we have some film footage. And the original film is just great as well. And last but not least, the George Butler documentary from, I think, the year 2000 or so, is a great documentary. Actually, that's the one which really got me to think, well, I should go to these places someday. Yes. The health. Yeah. Well, all the the seasickness and digestion, we all had parts of ammunition to fight this. None of them worked, so we just lay down watching movies. That seemed to be the best remedy. That was the only concern, but again, nothing. Nothing to lose sleep at night. There was no. It was more expectation, hopefully no one is going to break a leg in crevasse, including myself, but so that's kind of a problem, which is, no big deal if it happens in Greenwich High School, and much bigger deal if it happens in the end of the world. Time's ready. No, not really, actually. Even at the end, I wish we had an extra week or two to go through the Sandwich Islands, because we could only go to the northernmost one. And because of the ice, and because we used our spare time at the very beginning when we were stuck in a Puerto Williams with that storm, so we lost about 3-4 days there. We could not extend the trip, but that was more the other way around. Yes. The hardest part in this, at sea was around the South Sandwich Islands, where you see the rough seas, and all night, no one slept at night, and we could not anchor the boat. We were all moved around all the time, so that was tough, especially when said, well, there may be 5 boats in the story of humankind on these places. We won't. And in the mountain on the island, it was really when we had that storm. Not that we thought that there was a risk of losing one's life, although you never know, but it's just tough. I mean, you don't know if it's going to last 2 hours. And it can get, incrementally worse. I mean, so we're lucky that the tent was still with us, but what if the tent is blown away? And it's another order of magnitude of problems to manage. And also, we were maybe 20 people too, 9 people, so some different ideas, what we should do, should we go now, should we go later? So, it could have been worse. Yes? Something, if we had done something differently on the trip, I would have planned more time. And, as I said earlier, an extra week or two. And I would have brought another person for the filming. Because, this is hopefully, I think, a nice documentary, but with 1 or 2 more people to film, and a little bit more time, and a little bit more thinking ahead of time. We could have done maybe a series, season 1, season 2, and episodes on different subjects, and I think there was enough material potentially to develop different subjects. Is there yawning or is it wrong? Any questions? Oh, yes. How much? or the cost of the overall expedition? Well, excluding the film part, because the manufacturing of the film, if you would, after being back from the expedition is, you know, to give you an idea, is you know, close to $100,000 by the time you can editing, the color, the subtitles, the voiceover, the music, and all that. That's cost money. The expedition itself is about $300,000 plus of budget. The boat itself, if you want to rent that boat for a project to go skiing in South Georgia or whatever, is about $6,000 a day. The boat. So that will be there for 4 years or so, or it goes $200,000 plus. And that's a lean budget, by the way. You know, National Geographic, these guys doing the same thing, it would be 10 times more costly. Yeah, oh, sorry. Yeah, we have that here, because I can also fold the hands from here. There's a question. Oh, yes, sorry. Probably. If we have a problem with the food supply, this boat is big, and we had enough for the entire expedition, including for the first 3 weeks. We bought Argentine meat and fresh vegetables and greens and all that. So the food part for an expedition was actually quite a good surprise. Usually, sled and your food for 1 month. 1 month is on your sled, and after a week or two, because it's too exciting. The boat like this, it was a good, pleasant surprise. Yes?
There's significantly more daylight than where you were, in the spring or summer in the southern hemisphere?
We chose that period because, Shackleton was stuck in that part of the world for a year and a half plus. So we would not be there that long, but we had to choose when would we go. So we chose late October, early November, because there was enough daylight. It was after southern winter, enough daylight. We're still quite we're not close to the pole, so it's not an issue of having very short days. But still, we wanted to have enough light throughout the day. And also, add that we wanted to have the ice and snow hot enough so that we could do the crossing. And at the same time, we wanted to see, wildlife. So wildlife is starting to arrive in these and land on these islands for breeding and laying eggs in December, January, February, and all that. So that's why we picked that particular period. Ideally, for wildlife, you do it maybe in January, because you have these chicks and so on. Like this island of the, we have literally 3 million penguins on the island, if you in January. So we saw only a few hundred thousand. So that was a reason. But then if you were in January, then the ice would be, risk of crevasses and accidents would be much higher than the crossing and so on. Yes? No, I don't think it has anything to do with the environment. Frankly, from everything I've read, Well, I think first because there's no way to have been through that and reproduce the exact state of mind of the guys. And I think when you've been through what they've been through over a year and a half, and you know you're potentially hours away from seeing humans and being saved, your energy is probably multiplied by some factor which makes you do something extraordinary. The other thing is they had good weather. They had a good moon, no storm, compared to what we had, but taking that as an excuse, that they did it in 36 hours and they did it in 3 days. But our weather was terrible, which is what had to sequence our crossing. And he had a good weather, and he took advantage of that very smartly and went through. And actually, they didn't have the GPS and Google Earth resources we had, so it had never been crossed. So he had to make a few tries through different passes in the mountain to actually find one which would lead him to Stromness on the other side of the island. Yes? Happy to come home? Yes, happy to come home, wonderful family, and it's exciting. And yet, I think, that one I would have liked it to last another week or two. So, mixed my feelings, but always happy to be in Greenwich. Thank you guys. I wouldn't call what I'm doing here a career because my niece had a career. It's more the after being an engineer working as a management consultant for 6 years or so. Consulting group and then going on my own to invest in technology startups to advise them. So that's been my solo career actually for 30 years or so. It's just that I designed my life then, 30 plus years ago, to be totally independent, to have no boss, to do my own thing so that I could. First, I thought, just travel and adventure and where my curiosity would lead me, and eventually with this aspect of the environmental issues becoming more and more important, and me teaming up with Oslo First and then Green Cross, it took a size of its own, and it's, has been over half my life for the last 20 years, and now it's more like three quarters of what I'm doing is so it's a little bit of vision, desire, and also luck, and one thing leads to another, and if you know what you want and where you're going, with some luck, that works. Something has worked for me so far. Yes. Many plans, but the most important would be Russian Arctic, I mentioned earlier, and in a totally different area, I would be studying, creating an expedition to help scientists look at the health of the coral reefs in around Cuba and also in the Pacific, taking a few islands as samples of what's going on there. As you know, actually, again, in the New York Times today, about poor health of the coral reef in the Great Barrier Reef in Australia. That's a major issue with the sea oceans warming, becoming more acidic and stuff. It's a big problem. And I, not going to stay in the cold all my life, so I thought I'd doing something overboard or stupid. That's the distraction.
Thank you.